Hey Sampha, this is Rhea from Samaya. Now we are in part 2 of our company audit. This part 2 consists of mainly financial statements, dividend and LLP audit topics. We'll see the financial statement topic. Financial statements required to follow accounting standards, which in consultation with and examination of recommendations of NEFRA. In order to prepare the financial statements, we require accounting standards. In order to audit the financial statements, we require auditing standards. Where these auditing standards come from? Who gives us? NEFRA formulates and recommends the accounting standards. Financial statements are required to follow accounting standards, but insurance, banking, electricity companies need not follow because they have special act and special format of financial statements. So, as per section 129, these companies, insurance, banking, electricity companies need not follow accounting standards. Financial statements shall give a true and fair view of the state of affairs of the company at the end of the financial year. That is why we are following the accounting standards. We are following accounting standards to give true and fair view. Items in financial statements shall follow what? Accounting standards. Okay. After our preparing of financial statements, can we reopen the books of accounts? Yes. How could we reopen the books of accounts? As per section 130, a company shall not reopen its books of accounts or not recast its financial statements. Recasting is nothing but shifting from current to non-current, non-current to current, etc. And unless an application made by central government, income tax authority, SEBI, or by an order of tribunal or court. What does applications or order consist of? They consist that the relevant earlier accounts which were prepared in a fraudulent manner, or the affairs of the company were mismanaged, casting a doubt on reliability of financial statements. You see, financial statements were prepared using accounting standards to give a true and fair view, but they were made in a fraudulent manner or which cast a doubt on reliability of the financial statements, then they have to reopen the books of account by an application by central government or IT or regulatory authorities, but not beyond a period of 8 years. Can we reopen the books of account for beyond a period of 8 years? Yes, when the government issue a direction under section 128.5. When it extends the time limit, we can go beyond 8 years also. What about the company voluntarily revising its financial statements or board report, etc.? As per section 131, the financial statements or board report, when they do not comply with 129 or 134 sections, they may prepare revised of financial statements and board report for any of the three previous financial years. It's not mandatory to revise all the three previous financial years. It could go for any of the three previous financial years after obtaining a approval from tribunal, and a copy of order. Order of the tribunal shall be submitted to the registrar. That is, if in order to revise the financial statements of board report, what do we need to do? We need to apply for the tribunal. And that tribunal order shall be submitted with the registrar for revision of such financial statements or board report. With regards to CFS, as per section 129.3, CFS is mandatory for the company having one or more subsidiaries or associates which shall be led before the annual general meeting. That CFS shall be led before AGM. CFS should be prepared with respect to Schedule 3 and other accounting standards. The provisions also applicable to preparation, adoption and audit of financial statements of holding company shall also apply to CFS. That is, all the provisions that are governing the holding company also govern CFS. Is it mandatory for every company to file CFS if it has subsidiaries and associates? There were few exceptions for that. What are such exceptions? As we already seen it in FR, right? Whether it's an investment company or if a company that is subsidiary, it's a subsidiary. Make a note that it's a subsidiary, not a holding company. It's a subsidiary and its members who are entitled to vote and not entitled to vote. Even members who are not entitled to vote shall also be considered. intimated in writing that they do not object company for not presenting financial consolidated financial statements, that they are curtailing their right. Here, the ultimate company or intermediate holding company files CFS with register as per Ind AS, as per AS accounting standards. That is, a company can object. Plus, the ultimate company shall file its CFS with registered company. That is, even though the subsidiary is not filing CFS, its holding company or intermediary holding company shall file it to the registrar. Then it can take such exemption. Plus, the company's any securities were not listed in any stock exchange, whether inside or outside India. Okay. Financial statement disclosures were not made as per AS. What do we have to do when any kind of disclosures that were have to be made as per AS were not made? We have to write what deviation has occurred and what are the reasons for such deviations and what the financial impact of such deviations. Just like an audit finding, the deviation and reason for that and financial impact. If the managing director or full-time director, CFO, board member have not complied with such provisions that were discussed above, a penalty of minimum 50,000 to which could be extended to 5 lakhs and an imprisonment up to 1 year could be done. And with regards to the provisions of constitution of NEFRA, who constitutes NEFRA? NEFRA, as per section 132, CG may constitute NEFRA. For what? What's the duty of NEFRA? NEFRA to adoption or for making the companies to follow the accounting and auditing standards, formulate the auditing standards and accounting standards. NEFRA has power to make recommendations to central government on formulation and laying down accounting and auditing standards and monitoring those compliances, whether the companies were following the auditing and accounting standards. With regards to company and with regards to the auditor, NEFRA does both ways. It monitors the companies and it monitors the auditors also. So, it oversees the quality of the service of the profession and suggests improvement in any quality of service. And this is a grey area to perform such other functions which were mentioned by central government. NEFRA has powers. Does NEFRA rule all the companies? No, it rules only a few companies where whose securities were listed in any stock exchange or unlisted public companies whose paid up share capital is greater than or equal to 500 crore. That is, as soon as the paid up share capital touches 500 crore, NEFRA is applicable. Aggregate total turnover touches 1000 crore, NEFRA applicable. Aggregate outstanding loans, debentures, deposit touches 500 crore, NEFRA applicable as on 31st March previous financial year. And insurance, banking, electricity companies or any companies which were set up under special acts, NEFRA applicable. Or any company on whose reference made by NEFRA by central government with public interest, that is, central government had referred a company out of public interest to NEFRA, NEFRA is applicable. NEFRA rules ever applicable. That company has to report to NEFRA. Any body corporate or company registered outside India, but it is a subsidiary or associate of the above set, NEFRA applicable. Okay, how do these companies report? Other than the above companies, when NEFRA rules were came in, when the NEFRA rules had started, if you think these companies were a set A, all the negative A shall report within 30 days, inform NEFRA 1. And all the newly formed A companies, all these category A companies, after the NEFRA rules were in force, it shall, within 15 days, intimate NEFRA, inform NEFRA 1. Please make a note out of here. These were negative A as on the date of NEFRA rules. they continue to govern for NEFRA. NEFRA continue to govern for 3 years after it ceases to be listed or above limits were not met. That is, even after once any company had come under the umbrella of NEFRA, even though it does not satisfy any kind of these criteria, NEFRA will be, you have to report to NEFRA up to a period of 3 years, even such limits were not met. Every auditor, as we have already seen, the NEFRA regulates both companies and auditors. For the companies, it's form NEFRA 1. For the auditors, NEFRA 2. Form NEFRA 2, where on or before 30th November every year, they have to file form NEFRA 2. When such provisions were or rules or regulations that were formed by NEFRA were not satisfied or not complied, a penalty for individuals minimum 1 lakh. Up to, it could be extended up to 5 times the fees, and for the firm, it's minimum 5 lakhs and it could be extended to 10 times the fees. And it could also go for debarring the firm or member for a minimum 6 months to 10 years. These were again penalties. And for the balance sheet formats, balance sheet format should be of vertical format, that's mandatory. And Schedule 3 is applicable to all companies except insurance, banking and electricity companies and other special act companies, because they have their own format. And Schedule 3 consists of two divisions, Division 1 for the accounting standards and Division 2 for Ind AS. Part 1 was assets and liabilities, Part 2 is P&L for the under Division 1, and under Division 2, Part 1 balance sheet, Part 2 P&L, Part 3 CFS. P&L is always Part 2. Just a small reminder for that. Features of Schedule 3. What do Schedule 3 consist of? P&L balance sheet, right? With the picture of P&L or balance sheet in our head, we'll just figure out all the points that were given here. What are the disclosures? Disclosure requirements in Schedule 3 are in addition but not substitute to the disclosure requirements as per Act. As we already know, that Act supersedes the Ind AS, right? You have to not miss a disclosure. Only the reason that it was not present in Schedule 3. But if it is, have to be disclosed under Act, you have to mention that. And it requires presenting information through notes to accounts. Yes, so how do we disclose that? Through notes to accounts, we have to give cross-reference numberings to the notes to accounts, and all the notes to accounts shall contain corresponding amount of previous year. Okay, we know that, right? Current year, previous year amount. Okay, what are the features of Schedule 3? Disclosures, notes to accounts, numbering of that notes to accounts, in corresponding previous year amount. In order to ensure, how do we know financial statements have to follow the accounting standards? For what? That financial statements were true and fair. How do we know that financial statements were true and fair? What do financial statement contains of? It contains P&L balance sheet. P&L contains what? Opening stock, closing stock, expenses, profit. Balance sheet consists of assets, liabilities, right? So, we'll see with the P&L account. Assets are neither undervalued nor overvalued. They're talking about the opening and closing stock. No material asset is omitted. No material liability is omitted. Balance sheet. And P&L was prepared as per Part 2 of Schedule 3. And balance sheet is prepared as per Part 1 of Schedule 3. And accounting policies were followed consistently. Simple. P&L balance sheet, that's it. And now we are moving on to the second portion, that is dividend portion. Dividends can be declared from the following. What are the sources of dividends could be declared? As soon as we get profits, we cannot distribute everything, right? So we need to have a few plans with regards to the taxes or reinvestment opportunities or any kind of such things, right? So we'll see what all the things that revolves around dividend. Out of what balances we could issue the dividend is out of profits of current year out of the profits of previous years and out of balances of the above, that is like general reserves, and out of money provided by central government or state government. Please mention a note that these were not specific grants. It's like a general grant, generic grant. So it could be issued. That is profits of current year, previous year, and general reserves and money by central government or state government. And what are the factors that determine the dividend policies? Okay, as soon as we get profit, we cannot distribute everything. We have to see what all the things that have done, nature of earnings. We have sold some factory or immovable property, right? Immovable property. So there was current year, the profit was low. So we cannot issue whole sum as dividend, right? We have to reinvest that property and buy any other kind of immovable property, because it's a that income, that profit was out of capital nature. So the nature of earnings also have to be taken into consideration while issuing the dividend policy, and reinvestment alternatives and the liquidity and our working capital requirements and new capital requirements and market value of our shares and tax bracket of our shareholders and stability of the dividend. All these factors have to be taken into consideration before declaring the dividend. Okay, after the dividend has been declared by taking into consideration of all the factors, and what's the process of declaring that dividend? What the process of payment of that dividend to the shareholders? Further, dividend should be deposited in a scheduled bank within 5 days from the date of declaration. Within 5 days, you have to deposit in a separate bank account. Within 30 days, you have to pay that to the whom you will pay, to registered shareholders. How will you pay? You have abandoned non-moving stock. You cannot go and give that as a dividend, right? You have leftover Diwali sweets and you cannot go and give that as a dividend, right? You have to give that dividend as cash, check, warrant, and all in electronic mode. Only these were the eligible modes of issuing dividend. And okay, some shareholder have dues with me. When I have called for the money, he didn't pay. Can I cut that money and give the rest as a dividend to him? Yes, you could do. The board may deduct the payables by member due to pay. And if articles authorize, they can pay dividend in proportion to the paid up share capital. So with regards to the paid up share capital, that few were fully paid and few were partially paid, you could give dividend with regards to that proportional amount, and profits reserves can be capitalized by issuing bonus shares with regards to SEBI regulations. Okay, these were the provisions with regards to payment of dividends. Dividends should be deposited in scheduled bank separate account within 5 days from date of declaration. Dividends after declared becomes liability of the company and must be paid within 30 days. Payment of dividends should be made to registered shareholders, and dividends are not payable except in cash, check, warrant, or electronic mode. Profits or reserves can be capitalized by issuing fully paid up bonus shares subject to SEBI guidelines. If articles authorize, can pay dividend in proportionate of paid up on each share. Board may deduct the payables or members are due to pay. Okay, for any penal for any contraventions on payment of dividend rules, every director, imprisonment up to 2 years and a fine up to 1,000 per day. Company simple interest 18% per annum has to be given. Exceptions when these time limits were not followed. Due to what? Act. Whenever there was any money involved, what do you have to, you don't come here and read that these all were the exceptions in examination, right? What do you have to think? Whenever there was a money involved, there exists some rules and regulations, laws, right? Very stringent. So whenever there's any delay in payment of any money, what has to come to mind? We have to write about some laws and regulations. When there were any few exceptions here, due to operation of law, whenever there existed law disputes and whether that could be lawfully adjusted and by the direction of the shareholder. These were the exceptions which you could normally write. And for the unpaid dividend, okay, you have tried to reach all your registered shareholders and pay dividend in 30 days, but a few whose bank accounts got freezed and was not accepting any kind of credit, what do you have to do for that? Within 7 days, you have to transfer to unpaid dividend account. And if dividend is not claimed within 30 days from declaration and company, transfer to unpaid dividend account. Such transfer shall be made within 7 days from expiry of that 30 days. Okay? The company shall pay 12% interest if not transferred within 7 days. The company required to prepare statement containing name, address and unpaid dividend within 90 days and put it on its website. This is like making the registered shareholder, or it's a way to reach out the shareholder. And any money transferred to unpaid dividend, if not paid within 7 years, that shall be transferred to Investor Education and Protection Fund. Such details of such transfer shall be informed DIV-5 to authorities. What authorities? SEBI authorities. If any contraventions with regards to this unpaid dividend provisions, the penalty would be for the company minimum 1 lakh and rupees 500 per day. For continuing failure, maximum 10 lakhs. For any officer, it is 25,000 and 100 per day for continuing failure and maximum of 2 lakhs if it contravenes the provisions with regards to unpaid dividend. Now we have in our third and final topic, LLP audit. LLP is required to maintain annual accounts in true and fair manner. Okay. A statement of accounts in solvency shall be filed with every LLP with registrar every year. Audit is mandatory when the turnover more than or equal to 40 lakhs. That is, as soon as its turnover touches 40 lakhs, LLP audit is applicable. And its contribution touches 25 lakhs. Contribution is a capital contribution, touches 25 lakhs. LLP audit is applicable. No mandatory insurance is prescribed. Here, it could be asked as a true or false question and for your MCQ, which would weigh in you a mark. The creditworthiness of LLP is addressed through solvency declaration. Every LLP required to file annual return in Form 11. How do you remember this 11 LLP? This remembers you 11. With ROC within 60 days from closure of financial year, every LLP required to file statement of account and solvency in Form 8. Solvency 8 within a period of 30 days from the end of 6 months from the financial year. Okay, we have went in a hurry, right? Now we'll go it in detail. LLP is required to maintain its annual accounts. So there was no prescribed limit to maintain books of accounts. So if it's an LLP, it has to maintain annual accounts. In what format it has to maintain? It has to maintain in with regards to accounts and solvency. Whether audit is mandatory, no, audit is not mandatory. Until it touches 40 lakhs, it's mandatory. Whether the capital contribution touches 25 lakhs, it's mandatory. And the credit worthiness of such LLP is addressed through solvency declaration. And these were the compliance provisions with regards to annual return, Form 11. Solvency, it is 8. Solvency 8. 30 days from the end of the 6 months. Here, from end of 60 days from the closure of financial year. Things to remember. Registrar has power to obtain information from partner or employee. He can also summon if not furnished or not satisfied with the information or documents that were submitted. Documents available for inspection. what are all the LLP documents that were available for inspection with the registrar were incorporation document, names of the partners, statement of account and solvency, annual return, incorporation document, names of partners. These two were the compliance requirements that they have to submit to the registrar. What are the fees for inspection? Rupees 50. That's for the common people, and for the certified copy, we need to pay rupees 5 per page. If LLP not file relevant documents within due date, less than 300 days, normal filing fee plus additional fee. If it's beyond 300 days or more, normal filing fee plus additional fee plus liable to be prosecuted. Who appoints auditor of an LLP? Designated partner appoint auditors of LLP. When? At any time before the end of the financial year, at least 30 days prior to the end of financial year. Auditor is appointed by designated partners at least 30 days prior to the end of financial year. Filling of casual vacancy and caused by removal was appointed by designated partners only. All the power was with the designated partners. LLP's books of accounts shall contain what is books. Every LLP has to maintain books as and when it got registered under LLP, right? What books it has to maintain. All sums received and expended is basically a cash flow statement. Record of all assets and liabilities, something similar to a balance sheet. A statement of cost of goods sold, inventory, similar to P&L statement, and such other particulars or any other kind of information. What are the advantages of audit? Not only with regards to the LLP, it could be a generic question also. What do we usually say? What are the advantages of audit? We could get a loan. We could get investment, right? And what do we could do? It could be help in future disputes, right? Future disputes between the partners, etc., right? So with regards to those scenarios or those circumstances in mind, we'll figure out all the points here. What are the advantages of audit? It's to detect errors or frauds in the financial statements, whether kinds of any disputes or to obtain loans, that is for banks and financial institutions lend money to firms only on the basis of audited accounts and periodical visits, which help improving the management to improve the management and settling accounts between partners at time of admission, death, retirement, insolvency, etc. So in order to detect any kind of errors to resolve any disputes, so to banks to lend money and improve management and settling out of accounts between partners. Auditor's duty with regards to audit of LLP. Auditor should get definite instructions in writing as to the work to be performed by him. That's they're talking about the scope of the audit. The auditor should mention whether the records of the firm appear to be correct and reliable, whether he was able to obtain all information and explanation necessary for his work, whether any restriction was imposed on him. This is with regard to SA 200 series, like his auditor's duty to obtain true and fair view, and here is to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence and whether there were any restrictions that were imposed on him. The auditor should read what the auditor should read was the nature of business and the amount of capital that was contributed by the partner and the interest that they were getting and the duration of partnership and the drawings that were made by the partners and the salaries payable to partners, borrowing powers of the LLP, rights and duties of the partner and method of settlement of accounts between the partners at the time of admission or any loans that were advanced by the partners. That is, all the money related transaction to and fro between the partners with regards to any kind of capital or loans that were given or any kind of salaries, commissions, interest. All has to be read and seen by the auditor. These were the duties of the auditor, and this comes to the end of the company audit. Thank you.